What is up, YouTube? My name is G3 Iron, and today we are taking a look at our 100 maps of Atoll. First off, thank you so much to everybody that voted in the straw poll. The Atoll poll is what we ended up calling it, and this was a blast, especially coming off of 100 museum maps, which was just awful. So thanks so much to everybody for voting on that poll. There will, of course, be a poll down below as well for which 100 maps we're going to do next. So first off, taking a look at the character that we used to farm these 100 Atoll maps. Nothing has changed from our last couple of runs. I think I am going to make some tweaks for our next 100 runs, but you can see our total increased item quantity with our flat IIQ, slaying frozen enemies from the Windripper, normal enemies being slain from Biscos, and then with Divination Distill It Up, we've got a grand total of 140% increased item quantity. I think I'd like to upgrade these Gold Worm. They're not perfect. They're too off perfect. They're 18% increased quantity. I'd like to get those up, and I may make a few changes as well to some jewel setups as well as to some flask setups as well. But that's the character, and of course, that is all linked down below. Also linked is our meme image and our meme tab, which is included. This is what it felt like running 100 Atoll maps. It just felt so sublime to run this map as opposed to running the museum map. So we've got all of the images here in an Imgur album, including all of the loot. So if you'd like to take a look at what all the loot looked like, both pre-sort and post-sort, all of that is available down below. So what did we do for this particular setup, and how did we run these maps? So we crafted these maps with a lot of expenses, actually. We really went heavy on the expenses for this particular run. So for this particular set, we used alchemy orbs on all 100 maps. We used a sacrifice fragment, and then we used three sextants. So we sextanted the unique Atoll map that is near Atoll, and then the two tier two maps that are near Atoll. That was our sextant setups. When we rolled the maps, we had 16 reflect elemental or physical rolled maps, so we used 16 chaos to re-roll that, and then we used Zana's basic 6% increased quantity on each of the maps. We wasted one map because I forgot to throw in some sextants, so I ran an additional map in there. And this particular run, I wanted to break down how many times we ran into Einhar, Zana, and Nico. I didn't track Alva, just so if you've got questions about, hey, why didn't you track Alva? Honestly, because about halfway through I realized, should I have been tracking Alva this whole time? And I decided no, because I figured that Alva's spawn rate is going to be a little bit different than Nico and Zana's, just because whether or not your temple is ready to run or not, you can kind of target whether or not Alva is going to spawn. So decided not to include Alva. We had 19 total breaches that we encountered, 17 total abysses that we encountered. We encountered 8 trials, and then we did encounter one breach lord. It was Esh. So the grand total of investment was 566C was our estimated total amount of investment here. And you're wondering, did that pay off? Well, the short answer is no. The total profit that we made was 78 chaos. That was our total profit, and that was with a lucky exalted drop. So let's really quickly dive in and see exactly what all dropped through Atoll. But what a shock. It's really not that profitable running a tier one map. So in terms of map drops, we had Iceberg map. That was the most popular map that dropped for us. We're running at 141% completion percentage on 141 out of 159 at the moment on this particular atlas. So the quantity of icebergs that we dropped was 38. I might do 100 icebergs. I don't know. We'll see, to try and get that awesome iceberg, wonderful hideout. But you can see from the maps, all of these maps are really low tier and they're really low value because, of course, it's a low value map. So what a shock. Is it sustainable? Well, we had a grand total of 188 maps drop for us. And so when you consider the level of investment that we put in and we ran 100 maps, yes, you can sustain your map pool just from running tier one maps, which makes total sense because early on in a league, you got to run low tier maps and you got to hope that higher tier stuff drops. So of course you're going to be able to sustain, and of course the bell curve for playing the game is going to be built around that. In terms of the currency that we were able to farm and that dropped for us, we got really lucky. I think this was on map number 3 that we got the exalted to drop, and it dropped from the boss. And I was actually wondering on the third map, I was like, huh, should I actually kill the boss? And then the exalted dropped, and I was like, yeah, I guess I'm going to kill the boss for the rest of these maps. And then, of course, no more exalted dropped the rest of the time. So that seems to be a common occurrence. When we did the arcades and the museums, we've gotten some really high value drops within the first few maps, and then nothing the rest of the way, which is interesting. the number of chaos that dropped was 56, which was a good amount of pure chaos when you consider it. It's not good in terms of the returns for investment, but just in terms of flat chaos that's dropping, it's pretty nice. Jeweler's Orbs, I only picked up 6 sockets this particular run. I didn't pick up any flat Jeweler's Orbs on their own. And you'll see that in the videos that are playing right above me. You'll notice a lot of the times when I am looking at loot, a lot of really low tier currency isn't showing up on my filter right now because I wanted to filter it out. So this could have been much more profitable if you would have allowed for wider parameters. So like jewelers, alterations, silver coins, transmutes, none of those were going to show up on my loot filter. And so you could, in theory, have had a lot more profit from those smaller currency items, but I didn't want to pick them up. I just wanted to see the number of 6 sockets that dropped. And we had a grand total of 74 6 sockets drop for us. So that was quite cool to see. And of course, if you're looking at the loot tab, you'll see that that was a majority of the loot tab space for items was simply the 6 socket recipe. So that's always a good way to make some currency back. And I highly, highly recommend. If you don't know about the 6 socket recipe, it's simply finding an item that has 6 sockets, not 6 link, but 6 socket, and you sell it to a vendor and they give you 7 jeweler's orbs back. The fourth most valuable currency that we had was a splinter of Toll, because of course we had lots and lots of breaches thanks to sextants. Sextants can populate breaches onto your maps, and they did so quite frequently on our sextant rolls. Orbs of Alchemy. This was primarily due, the value of the alchemy isn't pure alchemy drops. The value is mostly through uniques. So you can see, of course, in the loot drop tab of just how many uniques that I got. And of course, I sold those for alchemy shards because the vast majority of them were absolutely worthless. They're worth more as orbs of alchemy shards, the reality of it. So that's what we did. It was spending a lot of time picking up uniques, and you can see that in some of the videos right above there. I just picked up some uniques, and occasionally I would even make a decision like, okay, I'm full on my stash tab. I am not going to go back just for this unique, because chances are this unique is a few alk shards. So again, depending on the parameters of your currency loot filter, this is profitable. The amount of time that you spend on it is going to make it less profitable than other things. But again, that's up to your discretion. That's one of the joys of doing this, is testing out how profitable it is, seeing whether or not running 100 maps is profitable, and what are the different tips and tricks that you can use to make it more profitable. I think expanding your loot filter in lower tier maps is obviously going to increase your profit, even if you're picking up more junk that you wouldn't necessarily pick up. Simply early on in the league, especially, if you can chain together a whole bunch of maps, because all this currency is based on mid-league prices. All this currency is going to change, of course, earlier on in the league. So if you can rush and chain sustain early maps, I think you can make a lot of money off of it, because there's a lot of players that are looking for even those early tier maps. That's going to change those values. So in terms of cards, what did we get? The most interesting thing was that we did farm up 5 of the wind, which provides a Windripper. So if you're early on in a league and you're saying, hey, I want to get my Magic Find character started, this puts us on pace to running about 125 atolls. Now, this is with 125% or 140% increase item quantity drop. So we've already got all of our magic set up found. But I think if you run about 150 to 200 maps, I think you could easily farm your own wind. Obviously, RNG being taken into account, maybe you've got to run a little bit more than 200. Maybe you've got to run a little less than 150. But that's right around your average of what you're looking at to farm your own Windripper. So again, if you're a league starter and you're wondering, hey, I think I just want to start out with my league starter and convert it into a Magic Find character, I think running Atoll is absolutely something that you could do, and it's sustainable. Again, we've shown that through the amount of maps that drop. We did have 14 of the Encroaching Darkness drop, so that's good if you want to expand out your Atlas early on in a league. Again, I think this is a great way to start out a league, is to target farm a particular tier 1 map. I don't think it's obviously as profitable later on in the league. The Valley of Steel boxes also dropped for us, which can be for Monstrous Treasure. That did not drop out of a Diviner's strong box, so that was really cool to have that drop. We also got a Valkyrie that dropped for us. Other miscellaneous stuff that dropped for us, of course, we had 74 of the 6 socket recipe, and then we did have a stacked deck. I haven't pulled that yet because I didn't want to have that affect the price and the profit, because stacked deck can pull anything. So I didn't want to mess with the average. I just wanted to pull the average value of stacked deck rather than trying to throw off the values of everything. We found one divine vessel. which the average price is 129. So I'm not sure why this is calculating out to 387. That should be 129 because we found one of them. Anyway, that changes our total a little bit, but not much. In terms of time spent on task, here's all of our MapWatch data, which, of course, is wonderful. You can check out MapWatch. It's a wonderful, wonderful tool for anybody that's doing any kind of testing. So if you're doing testing on your own for your own benefit, or if you're running a stream or your own YouTube channel, I would highly recommend that you check out MapWatch. I've exported all of this data here onto our main sheet. So the time on task was roughly 300 minutes and 20 seconds. The average time per map was roughly 3 minutes in total per map. The average time to complete a map was 2 minutes, 14 seconds. And the average time in town was roughly 45 seconds. So when you combine everything up and you go, okay, so this is like a 5 hour project for running 100 Atoll maps. That's really not bad. And when you consider it, if you're playing a league starter build on the first weekend, if you can rush to maps and then chain together a bunch of low tier maps, it can be very, very profitable and very, very safe. And the XP is going to be great as long as you're below level 83-ish. The XP is going to be really, really strong for you there. So in terms of the total number of clicks that we had was 994. So the value per click was 0.64. That was our total value. Really quickly wanted to go over the layout of Atoll map because I complained so much about the layout of museum map. This was a much better map. Obviously, it's Atoll. Duh, it's going to be easier. You're going to start out here towards the middle of the map, and as you start out in the middle, you can have a choice basically to choose if you're going to start going right or going left. For this concept map, a lot of the time I did go left, and a lot of the time I did go right. I did not run down the middle gauntlet to start because I figured if I'm splitting the middle gauntlet at the beginning, I'm going to have to double loop at some point, so I didn't want to have to double loop with my tracks at any particular point. So we just went in one direction or the other. So you can typically loop either going left and running around the left circle all the way through, or you can go right and then go up to the boss and then run all the way around, continuing down through the middle gauntlet and then proceeding through the left circle. Just depends on which side you want to do first. I found that in general, if I wanted to have more rampage stacks, starting left and going all the way around the left circle was a better idea, simply because there's more monsters to kill going left and then going to the boss arena. And then you've only got like these two corners to really finish off here after you've killed the boss, as opposed to starting out going right and then trying to pursue the boss. You're basically gonna reset your rampage stacks. If you are using rampage, you're pretty much gonna reset it at the boss arena, unless you're a little bit faster. I think that if I used a Devoto's Devotion instead of our Starconias, I could have improved my running speed, which would have improved it a little bit moving from the boss to the main area. You'll see in a couple of the videos above that there's a couple of times where I killed the boss and was able to make that work, but most of the time you're losing rampage stacks either going into the boss arena or coming out of the boss arena and then going around the next corner. I couldn't really identify a pattern of anywhere that Jun would repeatedly show up. She shows up a lot of the times in the corners, it seemed like, where Jun or Ty would show up for the Syndicate encounters. I'd locked out Syndicate encounters, as I'm doing for all of my Let's Run maps, simply because I don't want Syndicate drops to impact the currency total on the map, and so I've locked her into Research. It seems like Research spawns in the corners. I have no data whatsoever where Incursion, you know, the Assassination Intervention, transportation or fortification spawn, because everything for this particular map set was done with Research being locked out. Notably, breaches also do seem to like corners, but they also sometimes appear midway. Notably, there is an absence on the left top hand side. I don't think I hit one breach on the left hand middle side. Most of them were on the bottom sides of the double circle, or they were in the top left corner of the circles. I could be wrong on that, but that was where the vast majority of the 19 breaches were that we bumped into. Abysses, absolutely could not pinpoint any particular patterns in the 17 abysses that we found. Abysses just seemed to crop up. And a couple of times you'll note in the videos above that I would find an abyss and a breach. And if the abyss was near the breach, a lot of the times on these long straightaways, I would actually run both simultaneously, because the breach in and of itself, at the moment, with the way how breach spawn rates are and with how thin those particular ledges are in Atoll, there's just not enough monsters to spawn to keep your rampage going, even with the breach. So you'll want to spawn both the abyss as well as the breach on top of one another. Typically, my advice, especially when I'm magic finding and in party, is not to run an abyss plus a breach, because somebody's going to die from either one of the really deadly abyssal monsters, or of course, if a breach lord shows up, somebody's going to die and lose XP. But for this purposes, and this was low enough tier map, it seemed like I actually needed to run the abyss a lot of the times inside the breach in order to keep rampage going during the breach, even while the breach was still expanding. A lot of the time, just the mob count was really, really low. Of course, in Atoll, the last thing to say is that the middles are empty. So one of the reasons why Atolls take as long as they do to run are because there are these two massive, gigantic loops. So if there was area to run through, let's say something like maybe Plateau, where you can simply run over, or Arid Lake, where you can simply run over this massive open area, and really it's only the outside walls that corner the map or border the map, really Atoll is kind of the opposite of that. It's almost like you're running along a beach around a lake, and that middle area is just dead area. So even though maps only took on average like 2 minutes and 14 seconds inside the map, I think it would actually be a lot faster if you didn't have to travel all the way around, because you're essentially having to travel the greatest possible distance that you could travel. Occasionally Jun would show up here in the middle gauntlet. I did want to have just one word of caution for you guys in the middle gauntlet. If you are playing in a map and you know that you've gone over the majority of the layout, and you look and you check, hey, are there still 50 monsters remaining? Just be aware, because that means in whatever pocket you haven't hit yet, it means there's going to be 50 monsters there, or more than 50 monsters there. So just be aware of that. A couple of times I had close calls in the gauntlet because I wasn't paying attention, and maybe there were allies cannot die, there were rare mobs with allies cannot die, or maybe there were particular mobs that had additional crit to them, or maybe there was a strong box that would freeze you. Anyway, so if you're looking at your map and you're going, okay, well, there's only a few monsters left, and there's probably all in this one corner, just make sure that you're aware of that, because if you're a melee character and you leap slam into the middle of that, could potentially be dangerous that you're leap slamming to your death. Could be that you're leap slamming into something that's going to cast Volatile Dead, or a strong box that's going to explode, or allies cannot die on top of other allies cannot die. Anyway, so just a word to the wise there. A lot of the times in that mid gauntlet, that's the area that's kind of the remainder. And so as you're completing your second loop, that's where a lot of enemies are going to be located. Anyway, hopefully you enjoyed this video. As with all of our Let's Run maps, there's going to be a straw poll down below for what next 100 maps that we ought to run. Thank you so much for your votes. Thank you so much for watching. As always, if you enjoyed the video, feel free to subscribe for more PoE videos on a daily basis. And I hope today is the day that a Mirror of Calandra drops for you.